The Heroic Path versus The Path to Nowhere by J.R. Nyquist, November the 2nd, 2021. I will use the placeholder X to describe a certain medical treatment throughout the text, since it will be censored by YouTube otherwise. Quote, "His life is a piece of everlasting heart of nature herself. All man's life is, but the weak, who are many, know not the fact and are untrue to it in most times. The strong few are strong, heroic, perennial, because it cannot be hidden from them." End quote by Thomas Carlyle. The hero is concerned with seeing. The villain is merely concerned with the manipulation of appearances. What an accomplishment it is, indeed, to see behind the foliage of so-called appearances. Truth has its camouflage, its bodyguard of lies, if Churchill's paradox is admitted. Truth is also a moving target and a living thing, said Plato, never wholly captured by man, even in animated discourse. On the other hand, a lie needs no discourse at all, for repetition is not discourse. Being easier than truth, a lie prevails with those who want everything to be easy. This is why modernity prefers so-called experts. As Socrates once said of experts, quote, "They will appear to be omniscient and will generally know nothing. They will be tiresome, having the reputation of knowledge without the reality." End quote. The German idealist turned political realist Johann Gottlieb Fichte once delivered a lecture on the scholarly search for truth. In accordance with his transcendental philosophy, Fichte declared that everything about the so-called solid world of perceived things is misleading. Scholars still argue over Fichte's meaning, but if we consider the problem of truth for a moment, we discover how very thorny it is. After all, once we consult our need, our sense of loss or entitlement, or how unfair the world is, we lose sight of the truth altogether. Our self-pity, our cowardice, our want of backbone, indeed, transforms us and deforms us. What becomes of so-called seeing, then? To look with a needy eye is not seeing. To look with a power-hungry eye is to reduce everyone to prey and everything to cynicism. To see the truth requires faith, acceptance, grace, and humility. The truth, then, is very far from us. Where might we find truth, then? If we stopped and listened, we might hear the voice of God and the wind passing through the trees. And then, if we are faithful, we might distill a little truth from the sound. It is much easier to apply to that inverted world what Thomas Carlyle warned us about, that is, a world ruled by small men. In fact, the smallest man the world has ever seen. Encumbered by small ideas, mean ideas, false ideas. Welcome to the world of bureaucratic socialism, the managed economy, and the one-party state. Here is a land, sunk as Atlantis was sunk, but not underwater. Instead, it is a land drowning in lies. Oh yes, to those with a tin ear, it all sounds wonderful. Everyone will be equal under socialism. Poverty and war will be eliminated under socialism. And yet, the great socialists included Lenin, Stalin, Mao, Hitler, and Pol Pot, the greatest mass murderers of history. How do we explain it? Shall we make excuses for them? Shall we say that socialism had nothing to do with their crimes? Where are today's small ideas, mean ideas, false ideas taking us? To the devil. Always to the devil. Without turning around or stopping. Straight to the devil. All our instincts now boil down to a self-destructive impulse. As if we cannot help ourselves. Think for a moment about the pandemic. It is the surface phenomenon beneath which the discarded truth speaks out from a landscape that is soon to be moonscape. It is not safe for the truth to emerge at present. The rotter, the panderer, the climber, the false men, are now in charge. These are to the right of us, to the left of us, in front of us, and behind us. We live in the valley of the shadow of evil imbeciles. What is the name of the Marine Corps general, that Army and Air Force colonel, who threatened their troops to take the jab? My plan would be to name them and shame them, first on this small website, then on larger websites, and finally with their faces plastered on billboards and looking out through bars. Oh yes, in the days ahead, in our endless November of criminals, there will be an accounting. There will be a sifting and waiting. The Nuremberg Code will be applied to those who have illegally forced worthless acts on people who could not quit their jobs. Either the law is revived and a day of reckoning comes, or we are finished. Everyone knows that President Pantload has already outlived his shelf life. With the fiasco in Afghanistan and the X mandates, he represents Nietzsche's last man in the role of last president. After him comes the last woman, the socialist ogress who waits her inevitable turn. Then comes feminism's Waterloo. Oh, the ambition of it. Nothing could be more obvious. Harris is doomed. She is not yet president, but already she is the most hated prospective president in history. Meanwhile, the party of Break the Bank pandering is less and less solvent, more and more ridiculous, with each passing week. If next year's election is dishonestly played, or if the public wittingly marches into socialism, make your peace with God, Mars will begin his reign. The American establishment is much like the European establishment, a hierarchy of imposters and unwitting suicides. As they kill their country, they kill themselves. They know only one thing, pretense. To bring it all down to one issue, the Nobel laureate Luc Montagnier said that it is an historic blunder to X during a pandemic. He said, quote, "It's an enormous mistake, isn't it? A scientific error as well as a medical error. It is an unacceptable mistake," end quote. He said that the X program, which certainly includes government-mandated X, is quote-unquote unthinkable because it is killing people. Quote, "The new variants," he said, "result from the X. You see it in each country. In every country, death follows X." End quote. Here is a golden nugget of truth from an actual scientist. The pandemic will continue. The world economy will crumble. Wars, civil wars, world wars, etc. Should we say that Luc Montagnier is an ignoramus? No, he's not. But the establishment ignores him, marginalizes him, etc. What is signified by this? The suicide of the elites. As for science itself, what is science, then, if political frauds can marginalize a Nobel laureate? And if the Nobel laureate is a fraud, then official science is a fraud. But paradox of paradoxes, if the Nobel laureate is telling the truth, official science is still a fraud. That is the long and short of it. Meanwhile, the Chinese and Russians are gathering their forces. They are rubbing their hands in anticipation. The West is falling apart. The American idiots are even using X mandates to drive their best pilots out of the Air Force. They are recasting their military as an organization of men who will follow any order, however illegal. If soldiers will stick poison in their own veins, they will commit any atrocity. Watch. The fake heroes of the Joint Chiefs now congratulate themselves. They are giving US military personnel a toxic spike protein intravenously. Such an experiment has never been tried in all history. But here we are. Blood clotting, maybe? Organ damage? How dangerous? Nobody really knows. The generals, of course, are congratulating themselves. Which one has stood up for the troops? Is there one leader among them? To obey and facilitate the poisoning of their own troops is a special distinction. Shall we give them a medal? What to call such a medal? The spineless blackguard with poison oak clusters? The biographer of Marx, Lenin and Hitler, Robert Paine, was also the biographer of that architect of retreat from victory, General George C. Marshall. Aside from saying many stupid things about Marshall, Paine had one insightful passage, quote, "If the modern general is almost superhuman, he is also, far more often than he suspects, less than human." The historian concerned with the career of Marshall inevitably finds himself reading the autobiographies of lesser generals. They are not always pleasant reading, end quote. We can see nothing has changed in this regard since World War II. Paine added, quote, "General Bradley boasted frankly of his successes, but he had little to say about the disaster in the Ardennes, which resulted in 59,000 American casualties, a disaster which was due to his own failure in tactics," end quote. Modern Americans tend to think poorly of the Carthaginians for crucifying their bad generals. Americans should probably reconsider. One might ask where our great men have gone. When was the last time we had a truly great man to lead us? Would we even recognize a great man? It is worthwhile in this context to quote Carlyle's poignant summation, quote, "But of a great man especially, of him I will venture to assert that it is incredible he should have been other than true. It seems to me the primary foundation of him," end quote. Carlyle further argued that the great man is, quote, "what I call a sincere man. I should say sincerity, a deep, great, genuine sincerity, is the first characteristic of all men in any way heroic," end quote. Carlyle added that the great man, quote, "cannot help being sincere. The great fact of existence is great to him. Fly as he will, he cannot get out of the awful presence of this reality. His mind is so made, first of all, fearful and wonderful, real as life, real as death, is the universe to him. Though all men should forget its truth and walk in vain show, he cannot." End quote. Nobody who reads Carlyle will ever think of Mark Milley or Lloyd Austin as sincere or true. These men are on a path to nowhere because there is no truth in them. As Carlyle said, quote, "in every kind there is genuine and spurious," end quote. Biden is spurious, Austin is spurious, Milley is spurious. Most of our leaders, in fact, are spurious. Carlyle tells us the inspired is, quote, "in fact, the highest," end quote. People like Biden and Austin and Milley, who support political correctness, are among the lowest of the low. They are men of dry straw, lacking what Carlyle defined as originality, sincerity, genius, etc. The true hero, quote, "is he who lives in the inward sphere of things, in the true, divine, and eternal, which always exists, unseen to most," end quote. J. Nyquist, November 2, 2021.